All right. Well, I got a couple of emails this week from some of the folks in our classes, and they were such a joy to me because it's just people talking about their practice and how they're growing and how they're moving forward and making progress in their spiritual lives, starting to really enjoy some of the bliss in their practice. And I was just just skipping around, so happy, so excited to hear that happening. And so anyway, I pray for that. And I'm hoping for that for every one of us. There's no limit to that growth. There's no limit to how far we can go. And the amount of love that we can experience and see and live in is infinite for us. And so good on you. Those who are well, good on everybody. But I'm happy to hear practicing happening, and even more so, happiness and joy happening. So, well, last week, as you know, we ended our or the last part of our talk. We were having a knockdown, drag out fight over whether consciousness comes first or awareness comes first and which one's primary. And since we almost realized God thinking about that, I thought we better move on this week. And we'll just jump in. But the last one was his, just to frame it, not to reawaken the argument, because what argument? Who cares? When you get to the finish line and you can look back and see whether consciousness ended first or awareness ended first, good on you. We'll do it then. We'll then you can turn around and tell the rest of us stragglers, see, I was right. All right. So I'll just read that last paragraph because it is a good orienting paragraph for understanding things that Sri Nisargadatta Maharaj is going to teach within his context. And he says awareness is primordial. It is the original state, beginningless, endless, uncaused, unsupported, without parts, without change. Consciousness is on contact, a reflection against a surface, a state of duality. There can be no consciousness without awareness, but there can be awareness without consciousness, as in deep sleep. Awareness is absolute. Consciousness is relative to its content. Consciousness is always of something. Consciousness is partial and changeful. Awareness is total, changeless, calm, and silent. And it is the common matrix of every experience. Okay. So this being, this awareness, becomes consciousness as soon as we become aware of something. It's the consciousness is that particular. It's the directed attention of egoism, I would guess, is what he's kind of talking about. And awareness is a general. It's not aware of a particular. It's awareness in its pure state, in its pure form, in the form of Brahman, as it were, pure mind. All right. So our questioner hearing this says, well, how does one go beyond consciousness into awareness? So how do you cross that line? How do you go from one to the next? The Maharaj says, since it is awareness that makes consciousness possible, there is awareness in every state of consciousness. Therefore, the very consciousness of being conscious is already a movement in awareness. Interest in your stream of consciousness takes you to awareness. It is not a new state. It is at once recognized as the original basic existence, which is life itself, and also love and joy. So interesting there. It is not as new state. It is at once recognized as the original basic existence. So this is awareness, which is life itself, and also love and joy. So that he arrives at Satchitananda there, in awareness. That awareness and pure mind would probably be very close to the same thing. So he's saying that just if you're being conscious of the particulars, you're on your way to awareness because awareness is necessary And it's the particulars that are making it called consciousness. And he says to move toward awareness, become aware of awareness, which means that while you're paying attention to something, don't pay attention to the something, but pay attention to that within you that is paying attention. Become aware of that within you that is paying attention. It's like as you ask yourself a question, you know, how do I realize God? Instead of getting busy about how to go, what you need to go about in order to realize God, become surprised that something asked a question within you. Become interested in that, like, hey, wait a minute, where did that question come from? Who asked that question? Where did it arise? You know, this is becoming aware of awareness. It's taking the next level. And so when you're walking through a noisy street, normally we're paying attention to all the noise and looking around at all the colors and movements and things going on. As a sadhu, we walk down that street aware of that which is watching everything happening on the street. We're not concerned with what's happening on the street. We're not engaged in the outside portion of it. We're engaged on the inside, pondering who's watching all of this. Who's using my eyes right now? Who's using my ears right now? Who's wondering who's using my eyes right now? You know, and just start a different focus in the way that we pay attention in the world. Instead of being interested in the moving, in the changing, become curious about the unchanging that is behind all of it. And so this is that switch in focus in how we live. Instead of living in the outside world, we live in the inside world and respond or view the external world as an adjunct. It's not, we're not in it. It exists within us kind of thing, although that comes later. Once that starts happening, it's kind of hard to function once you start realizing that it exists within you. But as an idea and something to grow in conviction of, we know that the world exists within us and not external to us. The questioner says, well, since reality is all the time with us, what does self-realization consist of? Maharaj, well, that's interesting, actually. Since reality is all the time with us, yes, well, this is the whole thing of non-doership, non-accomplishment, non-attainment, you know, that our spiritual life is not about attaining a goal. It's about being in the reality as it is and not seeing it as we project it or as our mind thinks it is. Then he's asking that question. It says, since it's with us all the time, since we already are what we are, what does self-realization consist of? What's actually going on? The Maharaj, realization is but the opposite of ignorance. To take the world as real and one's self as unreal is ignorance, the cause of sorrow. To know the self as the only reality and all else as temporal and transient is freedom, peace, and joy. It is all very simple. Instead of seeing things as imagined, learn to see them as they are. It is like cleansing a mirror. The same mirror that shows you the world as it is will also show you your own face. The thought, I am, is the polishing cloth. Use it. Yeah, this thought of I am, of simple being, removes all interspatial thinking, you know, that where the mind is telling you what you're looking at. I remember sitting on a rock. This is long before I really had a spiritual life. It was just in San Francisco, probably early 90s. I was sitting on top of this hill, and I watched these two women come up, and they started doing some drumming down by another rock. I was sitting there, and my mind was making up a whole story about who they were. You know, oh, look, these two lesbians, I bet they're Wiccans, and they're coming up to do their thing for the solstice and blah, 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 and on and on and on. And I kind of snapped out of it. And I wrote a poem about it because I found it so interesting that I knew nothing about these two women. And so the first half of the poem, I wrote all of my projections, all the stories that my mind came up with to tell me about those women. And then the second half of the poem, the second stanza, I simply wrote only what I actually saw, what I actually knew. And it was a good time for me. I think it probably led to my spiritual investigation a few several years later. Was just this understanding that my whole life was a story, that I sit there and look at strangers all the time and know more about them than I ever really could know, because I make up the story, and that's how we get caught in a world of samskaras. That's how our samskaras work. They take our past and they recreate it in the present. They're like, oh, I've seen two women before, and the last time I saw these two women, this and that, and this and that. So that leaks into your experience of this moment and these two women, even though there's no relationship between them. And so to cleanse the mind of story is what we're trying to do by becoming aware of the moment, to be present, to be here, and only see what we see, only hear what we hear, only touch what we touch. Don't let the mind include anything else. Don't let the mind cloud it and make it part of its samskaras, part of its karma. Try and see it as karma free, see it as motivation free. We can really see how we're caught in that kind of thinking, because I don't know if this is just me. It might be. I'm weird enough for that. But sometimes you'll walk through a door and you'll hit the door jamb, right? And have you ever just turned and stopped and given it a dirty look? After you, like it was the door jamb's fault that you bumped into it on the way through the door. That we come up with, we even try to involve inanimate objects into our karma by casting blame. When we get frustrated trying to do something and you get angry and throw it across the room, to punish it, or a piece of trash falls out of the trash can and makes a mess on the kitchen floor. And when you pick it up, you throw it into the trash can. You just make sure that it knows better than to ever do that again, kind of thing. But you see how it's natural for us to spread our story, to spread our karma, and to explain the world. And by doing that, we define our world. And by doing that, we become enslaved. We are inside of a defined world, part of its definition, and we have to move along with it. And so he says, take the world as real and oneself as unreal is ignorance. So to see those things as being the things that are important and the things that need to be dealt with, and to see yourself as the thing that's going to die, is ignorance. To place the permanence on the world outside, oh, the world's going to go on. I'm the one that's going to pop out, This is ignorance, because nothing in the world goes on. Everything in the world from one moment to the next is different. So he says, that's ignorance, the cause of sorrow. To see yourself as the impermanent is your cause of sorrow. To view yourself as the changing. That's what attachment does to us. That's what moving into the moving mind, the changing mind, does to us. It causes sorrow because it's constantly pulling the floor out from under you. Not just the floor, it's constantly rearranging everything all the time. And we're left in a dazed state, just trying to make sense of it, trying to figure out, what does this mean? Where am I going? How come I can't get this done? And so we live in that state, and it's a state of fear. It's a state of frustration. It's a state of attachment, kind of where we're constantly trying to gather and maintain some kind of equilibrium. But it just seems that the world is constantly designed to throw a huge weight on one side of your boat and have you have to balance it out and make it work somehow. So to know the self as the only reality and all else as temporary and transient is freedom. So to absolutely literally flip the tables. And there's many scriptures that talk about that, that that's one of the things that Maya does. Maya makes up down and down up. It flips things around and makes that which is not helpful seem helpful. And so to know the self, that you are the reality, you're not the one that's going to pass, you're never going to pass. You will be forever. But you'll watch the world after world pass through you. You'll see them, observe them in the reflection of mind, in your own consciousness. you will observe this forever. You know, and if not that, something else, and if nothing else, then whatever state or whatever isness is when we arrive, that you are not the one that changes. As you walk down the street, the whole world is moving past you. You do not ever move. You are unchanging. So everything is passing through you like a stream of water, right? And so there is no sorrow in that. To know that the love within you is permanent, ever present, to know that you're in that desirelessness, you are ever free, ever pure, that you're not limited by your thoughts, you're not limited by a body, you are infinite. And that is where freedom, peace, and joy are not manifested, because they're always there. Well, the unchanging joy, the Brahman joy, the Brahman contentment, which these legal terms utterly, but those are emanating. Those are coming up as through experience, through just being what you are. They lie as the treasure battery within you that's always emanating beauty, always emanating peace. And then the mind ties it up into packages and makes it what it is. Interest in your stream of consciousness takes you to awareness, right? So watching the stream, not what's in the stream, but watching the stream itself leads you to awareness. It is not a new state. It is at once recognized as the original. So you'll find it, you'll know that you're there. It's at once recognized. And you'll be like, oh, wow, yes, this is right. You know, it snaps into place. You can tell, wow, yes, this is right. It's at once recognized as the original basic existence, which is life itself, and also love and joy. So life in itself, life itself contains love and joy. It contains Satchitananda. So he says, to know the self is the one reality and use as, I went up a state, up a paragraph. Instead of seeing things as imagined, learn to see them as they are. This is silencing the mind. That's basically all that sentence says, is when you look at something, see it as it is. Don't calculate, project, or analyze. Let it be exactly what is presented and nothing more. It is like cleaning a mirror. The same mirror that shows you the world as it is will also show you your own face. The thought I am is the polishing cloth. Use it. And the I am is just coming back to the moment. It's coming back and just resetting, silencing. You know, when you're getting caught up in your thinking, go somewhere for a second, step into the corner, and withdraw from your thinking. Withdraw from the whole scene as it's being presented. And just let it be. Remind yourself, in this moment, I'm undefined. I have no definition. I have no momentum in a direction. I'm utterly free. I need nothing. And then turn and just do things that appear. Do things that appear before you, and do them with your whole attention. Again, keeping the mind silent, just purely engaged in what it's doing, focusing completely on the moment and moving from things, one thing to the next, as they present themselves, one thing after another. Nothing adding to anything, nothing building anything, all things just being exercises in isness and experiencing, allowing the experience of bliss and contentment to arise from your nature. You know, just allowing them to be there. It's like the difference between lighting incense in a windy day and lighting incense in a still room. You know, if you light incense on a windy day, you might as well not light it. It just blows away as soon as it comes off the stick. But if you do it in a quiet room, oh, the beauty of that incense kind of coming up, you know, that line, and then it disappears into a single layer of cloud that sort of expands through the room. And then when somebody walks in, it swirls behind them and mixes with the air. Why is he saying this? Who knows? But it's this experience of being. The being is allowing the incense to arise, allowing the experience to arise in the stillness of the mind, watching it and seeing it and observing it, but not unpackaging it, not defining it, just being there. in that stillness. And so this constant withdrawal or this constant resetting to the still point is part of practice. And you can do that through mantra. Mantra is that same still point. Mantra is a placeholder for that still point, let's say it that way. It brings the mind to the reality, to the unchanging bliss inside. All right, so the next section here is called The Person Is Not Reality. And his first question is one that all of us are going to love to ask. Kindly tell us how you realized. How did you do this undoable thing? What caused this uncaused state in you? It's one of the things that shows the need for meditation and contemplation, actually, because one of the things I always joke about with folks is like, in Vedanta, the first thing you learn is that you were never born and you will never die. And as every good Vedanta student, your very first question is, what happens when I die? And so this is how it is. So this question kind of comes from that same space, because we all know that realization is the one cause with no one effect with no cause, it said. So it's an impossible question to answer. You know, how did you get realized? So Maharaj just says, well, I met my guru when I was 34 and I realized by 37. You see, there's no how in there. This is what happened. Well, what happened? What was the change? So that's not the question I asked. And Maharaj says, listen to this. This is going to be very, very insightful. Pleasure and pain lost their sway over me. All right, so that's the first thing he mentions. Pleasure and pain lost their sway over me. I no longer reacted to pleasure and pain differently. I saw them both as mere, what do you call that? Mere, welcome to my portal of age here. Let's see. The impetus, you know, the when you touch your face, it's your finger that touches your face. So he's saying that touch, a sensation, that's the word I'm looking for, that pleasure and pain are just sensation, and really they're the same sensation. You know, it's the mind that interprets them differently and takes them differently. You know, in some of the therapy that I've done in the past and even in the present, one of the good practices that I've learned from this particular therapist is that when you feel something inside that's causing pain or causing darkness or causing something, instead of feeling a defensive response to it, interpreting it as pain and undesired and then becoming resistant to it, she says, lean into it. Pretend you like it. Pretend you love that feeling. And just go, enter into that feeling, embracing it. And the more you feel it, just embrace it. Just open to it completely. And then listen to it. What is it asking? What is it trying to show you? And this has worked for me every single time. Just changing that resistance, you know, oh, this is pain, resist. Oh, this is pain, don't go there, don't look there, be careful there. Instead of interpreting it that way and going forward as you've been taught to act in the face of pain, change that, since there's no reason for it. Just change it and walk into it fearlessly and accept it. Accept pain as much as you accept pleasure in life. Don't treat them differently. Understand they are both just sensations in mind. They are both just sequences of thoughts. They are not in themselves real. It's your story that determines your relationship with them. So he says, what happened? What was the change? Well, pleasure and pain lost their sway over me. I was free from desire and fear. All right, and desire and fear have a relationship. Quite often desire is in reaction to fear, trying to make something better, trying to make something more pleasant. So he was free from desire and fear. I found myself full. All right. He found himself full, which means when he began to pay attention to the soul, to the self as spirit, he found no hunger there. He found no need there. He found no dissatisfaction there. I found myself full. This implies that he was full before he found it. So that our hunger and our constant need, activity and change is not because we are actually in need or because we're actually hungry. It's because we're paying attention to the wrong signals. We're paying attention to the signals of pain and pleasure and desire and fear. And he's saying that on his realization, those were the first two things that were left behind. They no longer held a sway over him. And in that stillness of not being driven by pain and pleasure and not being distracted by desire and fear, he finds himself full, needing nothing. I saw that in the ocean of pure awareness, on the surface of the universal consciousness, the numberless waves of the phenomenal world arise and subside beginninglessly and endlessly. As consciousness, they are all me. Okay? That's that equanimous thinking. The pleasure and the pain are not two different things. They are sensations. They are arrangements of thought in the mind. They are the same. So it's this knowing that all of this change, all the stuff that we, when we live in mind, we're subject to because we've put our boat on the waves. And so we're up and down, left and right, in danger, not in danger, having a good time, having a bad time. We're all caught up in that phenomenal world. And he says that in this realization, he says as consciousness, he realizes they are all me, that we are linked. We can't be separated. Their reality exists in me. As consciousness, they are all me. As events, they are all mine. So all of those strings come back to this central post. There is a mysterious power that looks after them. A mysterious power. Okay? Something seems to be happening. Something seems to be moving. There is a seeming power involved. And yet what that is still mysterious. That power is awareness, self, life, God, whatever name you give it. All right, well, there's an interesting thing. That power is awareness. So he sees all of these as being synonyms. Awareness, self. Is that me? Awareness, self, life, God. So this isness, this being, this existence, this self, this seeming awareness with this awareness within us, this life force, its energy, its prana, whatever name you give it, that power that is looking after the world is the same power that animates you, that is fundamental to you, that is within you. So the nature of the change in the world and the nature of you are one and the same. They all come back to this central, unchanging absolute that's established at your very center. It is the foundation, the ultimate support of all that is. Just like gold is the basis for all gold jewelry, and it is so intimately ours. Abstract the name and shape from jewelry, and the gold becomes obvious. Be free of name and form and of the desires and fears they create. Then what remains? You know, that's the secret, is to all these things that change, let them change. Let them disappear and pay attention to what is remaining. You know, in the mind, as you're watching all of that, it's, you know, to see your active mind, to see your restless mind as an opportunity is what we're getting at right here. So when your mind is moving and misbehaving, when that toddler, has had a cup of coffee and gotten stung by a bee and is running around completely dragging your consciousness everywhere through all the different corners, take that as an opportunity. Take that as an opportunity. Begin your discernment. Take up one of the things that arises and notice that it disappears. Notice that that's the nature of everything. What we're going for is this essence of essence, the isness of isness. We're trying to not see things as they've been defined after they happened, but seeing the essence of what was behind them. What was the unchanging aspect of all of this? And that unchanging aspect is always at the center of you. It's always the capital S self. And that is what's giving life to the changing world. Excuse me. That's what's su supporting and rising up everything around you. And it's intimately ours, as bhaktis, you can grab that from the gyanis here. The intimacy of God, the intimacy of life within you, the intimacy of awareness, the intimacy of the self is overwhelming, especially when you have become to suspect the nature of that self, of pure love, and to have this deep intimacy, this more than intimacy, much more than intimacy between you and this love, this self, this God, this divine, this beloved, is what remains when all else ceases. It is the thing that endures, and it is that which is you. In your essence of essence, your nature of nature, and everything that you've ever wanted or desired, you've wanted or desired because you've recognized qualities of that nature within that thing, that object. You've defined it and placed it outside of yourself. But that placing anything outside of yourself is the delusion. There is nothing outside of yourself. All of the world that you're dealing with is within your mind. All of the people that you love exist within your mind. This is a very intimate experience of life. It's ourself with ourself, the knower with the knower. And we have to move out of an ignorant mind, a mind that only has relative thought, and so constantly changing content, constantly shifting content. We have to move out of that, find the essence of it. What is it in my mind that never changes? Well, it's the awareness of what's in your mind that never changes. It's always present, always there. And so this discernment that Thakur talks about, this is what that discernment is. It's trying to keep your eyes on the essence of everything, knowing that it's all within you, that it's all of the nature of God, and that the one unchanging thing is the only thing in all of it that is real, that is authentic. So abstract the name and shape from the jewelry. So don't see the jewelry, see the gold. And the gold becomes obvious. Be free of name and form. Don't see the name and form, and the desires they create. Don't see those. What's remaining then? This life, this Satchitananda is what remains, when everything else stills. And that is everything. You say, well, because because everything is composed of it, and it's your own. Satchitananda, which another illegal statement. It's your own Satchitananda that is everything that you perceive. That is everything that you perceive. The existence of the tree outside of my window is only because of the existence within me. That same existence, that same ability to manifest and be, that is causing the tree. Is also causing me. We are of the same quality, the same quality is the wrong word again. We are of the same isness, the same essence. And so we look for that, we see that, and we begin moving in that. You begin making your life happen within that arena, God to God, you to you. Yeah, intimacy, and taking care of the environment no longer becomes a political essence. It's taking care of yourself. That's all it is. Taking care of your neighbor no longer becomes a service. It becomes you taking care of yourself. You loving your family no longer becomes a matter of relationship. It becomes you taking care of another part of yourself. And see how careful we are about taking care of ourselves. And that is what spreads. That's what magnifies. The more we come to understand, the more we come to see and to experience the world as us, as we. We don't look at our partners and think, where are their thoughts coming from? We know where their thoughts come from, the same place our thoughts come from. And they are just as much a world within their mind as you are within your world and your mind. And your struggles and their struggles have often been exactly the same. And this is where empathy grows. Empathy is reality. Empathy is not just an idea of identifying yourself with someone else. Empathy is recognizing the oneness between everything and that you can live in that kind of world. You can build in that kind of world. So be free of name and form and the desires and fears they create. Then what remains? Questioner, nothingness. Maharaj, yes, the void remains, but the void is full to the brim. It is the eternal potential, as consciousness is the eternal actual. Ooh, I like that. That's cool. That's something we could unpack. So yes, the void remains. So the void is not nothing. The void is full to the brim. It can be anything, always. It will manifest whatever. It's like the 3D printer of the Lord, as it were. It's full to the brim. It is the eternal potential, as consciousness is the eternal actual. So the eternal potential is the everything. At the top of the mountain, in one bunch, it's the Big Bang. It's that which went bang at the Big Bang. It's just an impossible conglomeration of all potentialities at a single point. And consciousness is when you step inside of it. Consciousness is when this awareness, which is the full potential of all possibilities at once in a single point, consciousness is when it explodes, and suddenly there are objects within awareness, and now you have consciousness, according to Sri Nisargadatta Maharaj. So we become conscious of a universe, conscious of what those potentialities became, but knowing that the potentialities still exist within all of the objects that we see. So the potentiality has become an actuality, but the actuality still is of the nature of its potential. Still the nature of its potentiality. So you see, everything still has that single point that was the initial bang of the Big Bang. Everything, even you in this moment, that's what we're trying to understand about ourselves. That's what freedom means. To understand that we are not the actuality here of this of the explosion of our potential. This isn't us. We are that potential within for everything. And that potential is still true. You do not have to wake up this morning and be a retired woman in a retired community. You can wake up this morning and decide you're just going to walk out your door and you're going to walk a straight line for the rest of your life, and nothing will define you. You can go out and decide to spend your life savings on a hot air balloon and just decide to go. I'm just going. No reason, no place, no destination. I'm just going. So understand that every moment you are that potential of everything. There is no limit to you but your own mind. That you could be 98 years old and still write your award-winning novel. It's like, not that that's the point, but I'm just making the statement. Be free. Play in this world. If mother has the gall and gumption to call this world a play, then by all means, play. By all means, play, but always play from the understanding that the potential is infinite, the game is endless. It goes on, and there is no point. And when you cease to be interested, fine, beautiful. because then you'll retreat back to your throne of pure potential, the potential of every possibility at one point outside of time. Yes, the void remains, but the void is full to the brim. It is the eternal potential, as consciousness is the eternal actual. Boy, I like that. I'd love to wear a t-shirt that said that. Be nothing more pretentious. By potential, you mean the future? Maharaj, past, present, and future. They are all there, and infinitely more. But since the void, it is of little use to us, the questioner says. Maharaj, how can you say so? Without breach in continuity, how can there be rebirth? Can there be renewal without death? Even the darkness of sleep is refreshing and rejuvenating. Without death, we would have been bogged up forever in eternal senility. Yeah, so which is true, you know, the sexuality, it's just clogging the drains, clogging the pipes. You know, this constant flow of things happening is what fills our mind with all this delusion. Even sleep is refreshing and rejuvenating, you know. Even my broken leg gave me that rest and that reset and gave me a deeper appreciation and knowledge of body and its relationship to me. So you see, it's that recognizing meaning in all of the actualities that happen because they come from the potentiality of pure love, pure wisdom, and existence. And so it's knowing that in everything that we look at. You know, one of my vlogs this week, we talked about that the first thing you have to do is believe in this world. Know that everything in this world has meaning. And that meaning is determined by its essence, and that essence is love. And it's that love that makes this worthwhile. It's that love that makes this meaningful and profound. It's that love that can allow us to exist regardless of how simple our life becomes and how small our effect seems to be. You know, that it's love, this infinite potential within you, that is the point of your life. To realize this infinite potential at a single point outside of time within you, that is love and wisdom. And once you know that, once you've touched the source of that, you are a gift to a great number of people. You know? And it's yours to find. That's the game, perhaps. Maybe it's just one small thing in a very big game. So the questioner says, well, is there no such thing as immortality then? Maharaj, when life and death are seen as essential to each other, as two aspects of one being, that is immortality. To see the end in the beginning and the beginning in the end is the intimation of eternity. Definitely. Immortality is not continuity. Only the process of change continues. Nothing lasts. So when life and death are seen as essential to each other, yeah, you can't have one without the other. Absolutely, one defines the other. One gives you the boundaries for them. But they're two aspects of one being. They're just aspects of being. It's not being gets turned on and being gets turned off. It's that they both exist within awareness as necessary boundaries for the story, for the play to happen. And to know that, that's immortality, because you make yourself realize you're not body-mind. You're not the things that are appearing and disappearing. Things are appearing and disappearing within you. You are the potentiality that allows that. You are that. You know, when one of the things Sri Nishagadatta was asked at some point, we'll read it at some point, I imagine. He was asked, what are you or who are you? And he says, I'm simply a place where things happen. This body is a place where things happen. You know, your awareness within your awareness is just a place where things happen. That's his definition of self, not the doer, just the potential, the possibility. I am the place where things happen. Continues. Nothing lasts. Awareness lasts, the questioner asks. Maharaj, awareness is not of time. Time exists in consciousness only. Beyond consciousness, where is time and space? So this he doesn't say whether awareness lasts or doesn't last. He says this word last doesn't make any sense because the word lasts implies the passage of time. It implies that time has an influence on awareness. And he's saying awareness is not in time. Awareness is long, is the container of time. You know, time exists in consciousness only. So time is a matter of mind. Your mind gives you the illusion of time. And it applies the illusion to the body. But you are above that, watching them both. You observed your body as a child, you observe your body as a youth, you observe your body as a middle-aged person, and you observe what's left of your body when you're extremely aged. But you all the time, that's a beautiful face. So this awareness remains constant and remains the same. You are eternally young in that sense. You're eternally free in that sense. You see, old age begins to decay the mind and the body more when it's believed. When you don't exert your freedom over it, you begin to define yourself by it. You give up early. You know, oh, it hurts to stand up, so you avoid standing up. Well, that's not the way to do it. Dive in there, lean into that pain, love that pain. It means you're not dead yet. Means your body's still there and you're still full of the potentiality of actuality, of actualizing that nature. And so lean into it, you know, lean into it. Live. Mother wants you to live. You know, it's a primary thought of mine in the last couple of weeks, and I'm liking what it's doing. Because I've been so focused on realization and so focused on getting out, you know, that I just feel like I've missed a very important aspect. And that is, Mother doesn't want me out. You know, she doesn't want me out right now. This is her will. This is the divine. And there's meaning in that. There's meaning in that. And the meaning is, I can see more love. I can see more wisdom. I can grow in my understanding of existence. You know, I can play. And so to know this, to hold in my mind my gyani, you know, to put in the corner of my dhoti, Thakur says, my gyani, my gyana, my knowledge that the where everything is changing and all that changes is unreal, but that I am that ever-present, absolute, unchanging myself within which all of this happens. I am this full potential of this eternal existence. And to watch the world from that perspective, that's what removes fear. That's what removes hunger and desire. And that's what removes anxiety and trouble and allows us to perform in that highest state perfectly in each moment. And maybe even in the lower states. Maybe it's just a matter we can't see the perfection of our action in the lower states. But. So awareness lasts. Awareness is not time. Time exists in consciousness only. Beyond consciousness, where are time and space? You could experience that in a little bit. You know, there's a book called Drawing on the Right Side of the Brain, which is one of my favorites, and I mention it quite a bit, by Betty Edwards. And she's an artist. And she came to learn through that her thing at the beginning of her book, she says, everybody can draw. It's not something that we have to learn. It's an inherent ability in every person. She says, but there's two halves to your brain. There's the left side and the right side. She says, the left side is linear. The right side is relational, you know, spatial. And so, and in the front of her book, she talks about lots of very cool experiences that show the differences between right and left brain. And she does these drawing exercises that teach you how to shift from your left brain to your right brain. And when you're in right brain, drawing is natural to you. in your right brain, you see the relationships of shades and colors and shapes and forms, all of them within each other. In your left brain, you only see symbols of these relationships. And she says, because most of us are raised in a left brain world, our whole education system is left brain. All of this has a point. I'll get to it in a minute. But as in this left brain, when you're asked to draw a face, everybody draws a symbol of a face because that's what the left brain offers, just a symbol of the thing. It doesn't have the spatial relational information. So you draw a circle and a nose and a mouth and two dots for eyes, and you've drawn the symbol that the left brain uses to represent face. Well, she gives you these exercises that teaches you to switch your inhabitants, your attention from left brain to right brain. And in right brain, when you draw that. You draw the relational, spatial relationships between things, the lights and darks and whatnot. And immediately, and I can guarantee you this, because the other thing she has you do in the book is when you sit down the first day of the book, the first thing she wants you to do is draw five things, just cold turkey. And so you draw them, and they're the worst drawings in your life. 2 weeks later, if you follow the book sequentially and do the practices, she has you do those five drawings again, this time inhabiting your right brain. And the difference between them is the difference between a kindergartner and an artist. It's unbelievable that you have this potential possibility within you that you just simply don't know because you spend all of your time in left brain. And one of the aspects, okay, here, all of that for this one small point. In that right brain state, time disappears. When you're over there drawing in right brain, 2 hours can pass, and you just suddenly come to and realize, oh my God, where have I been? I can't, where did that time go? And there's several things that you can learn from that. One is that inhabiting parts of your mind is exactly what we're doing in this world. That's why we don't see God, right? We don't understand. So we have to move out for that change. We have to move out of the thinking presence and into the being presence, the heart presence, the isness of the moment. And in that state, time also disappears. It doesn't become the functional factor for us because we're not seeing things karmically like that. You know, we're not seeing things karmically. We're seeing things in their true light. So awareness is not of time. Questioner, well, within the field of your consciousness, there is your body also. Well, of course, Maharaj says, but the idea my body as different from other bodies is not there. To me, it is a body, not my body, a mind, not my mind. The mind looks after the body, all right. I need not interfere. What needs to be done is being done in the normal and natural way. This is an interesting statement. This is that idea you are not the doer, that you're not the one taking care of these things, that all these things are happening and you're taking responsibility for them, and that false identity is what makes you anxious about all of them. Because he says the mind looks after the body just fine. The mind knows what the body needs. The mind knows how to go to the refrigerator and get a glass of milk. And it will do it of its own accord. And the mind knows when the milk runs out in the refrigerator that it needs to go to the grocery store. And the mind knows that to go to the grocery store, it needs money. The mind knows that to need get money, it needs a job. So all these things are obvious within the flow of karmic living, of the changing world. And it happens of its own accord. It will happen of its own accord. That will be the big surprise to you. You know, that this self, what the making the self responsible for everything, yeah, is ignorance. So he says, the mind looks after the body, all right. I need not interfere. What needs to be done is being done in the normal and natural way. You may not be quite conscious of your physiological functions, but when it comes to thoughts and feelings, desires and fears, you become acutely self-conscious. To me, these two are largely unconscious. I find myself talking to people or doing things quite correctly and appropriately without being very much conscious of them. It looks as if I live my physical waking life automatically, reacting spontaneously and accurately. So he's, that the observer, when we get practiced at this witnessing, when we've learned the separation from body and mind, this is what starts to happen. You begin to realize the truth of your non-doership. It becomes obvious to you that the karmic wheel is rolling down the hill and that it is not you rolling down the hill. And you don't have to chase it, and you don't have to try and stop it, and you don't have to jump on it, and become part of its misery joy cycle. That is all happening within. It does not identify with you, cannot cling to you. You may not be quite conscious of your physiological functions, but when it comes to thoughts and feelings, desires and fears, then you become acutely self-conscious. To me, these too are largely unconscious. I find myself talking to people or doing things quite correctly and appropriately without being very much conscious of them. It looks as if I live my physical waking life automatically, reacting spontaneously and accurately. The questioner, does this spontaneous response come as a result of realization or by training? Maharaj, both. Devotion to you, to your goal, makes you live a clean and orderly life. Given to search for truth and to helping people, and realization makes noble virtue easy and spontaneous by removing for good the obstacles in the shape of desires and fears and wrong ideas. Don't you have desires and fears anymore? Maharaj, my destiny was to be born a simple man, a commoner, a humble tradesman, with little of formal education. My life was the common kind, with common desires and common fears. When through my faith in my teacher and obedience to his words, I realized my true being, I left behind my human nature to look after itself until its destiny is exhausted. Occasionally, an old reaction or an old emotional or mental happens in the mind, but it is at once noticed and discarded. After all, as long as one is burdened with a person, one is exposed to its idiosyncrasies and habits. Are you afraid of death? I am dead already. All right, and that's where we're going to stop for this morning.